All right, everybody. Welcome to the Class of 1980 classroom. Welcome to the Leaders Forum. It's good to see everyone here today. This is a global network event, so I also want to welcome students and faculty from around the Global Network for Advanced Management who are watching. We appreciate the fact that students from the network have submitted some questions for today's event. I'm delighted to introduce our distinguished guest, Dr. Irene Rosenfeld. She is chairman and CEO of Mondelez International. After receiving her PhD in marketing and statistics from Cornell, Irene began her career in consumer research. She joined General Foods, which later became part of Kraft. At Kraft, she led the restructuring and turnaround of key businesses in the US, Canada, and in Mexico. She served on a team that spearheaded the company's initial IPO in 2001 and successfully integrated the Nabisco, LU, and Cadbury businesses. She took a short break from Kraft in 2004 to be chairman and CEO of Frito-Lay for 2 years. She returned to Kraft in 2006 as CEO and then chairman in March 2007. She successfully repositioned the company to deliver consistently top-tier growth by reinvigorating iconic brands, transforming the portfolio, and strengthening its presence in growing emerging markets. In October 2012, Dr. Rosenfeld made the strategic decision to spin off the company's North American grocery operations. She then became chairman and CEO of Mondelez International. Mondelez's revenue in 2012 was, I hope I got this number right, $35 billion, making it a world leader in chocolate, biscuits, gum, candy, coffee, and powdered beverages. You recognize many of its big brands, Cadbury, Nabisco, Oreo, Tang, and Trident. The Financial Times, Fortune, Forbes have repeatedly ranked our special guest today on their list of top women in global business, 50 most powerful women in business, and as one of the world's top most powerful women. Besides being delighted to welcome our speaker today, because she does indeed lead global business and contributes to business and society in many ways, I'm delighted that she's the mother of a current Yale SOM student. I'm also delighted, yes. I understand that this visit was not allowed last year, but it was allowed this year. I'm also delighted that Professor Sharon Oster, my predecessor, has offered to moderate this discussion with our speaker and the subsequent Q&A with you. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Irene Rosenfeld to Yale School of Management.
So welcome, Irene, and thank you all for coming. I'm going to begin and ask some questions, and then at some point I'm going to turn it over to the students to have at you. I do have a few questions from the Global Network as well, and I think we'll enjoy listening to how all the students interact. So as Ted suggested, I look at your career and I see, except for that brief couple of years at Frito-Lay, we'll have to talk about Indra over lunch. you'd spent your life at Kraft in a place in which those of us who grew up in the US, it could not be more American. Ritz crackers, yes. Tang, the astronaut drink, all the sort of Oreos cookies that we grew up with. And you spent your life there, and yet Kraft, of course, changed dramatically over this period. It left the Atria family, it stood on its own, eventually you spun the grocery piece of it out and created Mondelez. Tell us when you came back as CEO in 06, and you looked at the Kraft you had left only a couple of years before. What kinds of things did you see that made you think, something's got to change, I've got to do something different here?
You know, it was It was a challenging time when I came back. The first decision I really had to make is whether the company could be fixed. There was no question it had fallen on some tough times. The earnings had stagnated for about 5 years. The stock price was fairly flat. The company had not met the targets that had been set in the initial spinoff from Altria. And more importantly, under the covers, a lot of things had happened to our franchises. These were incredibly robust franchises. These are household names, mm-hmm. as you and Ted have alluded to. And the challenge was that over the intervening time after I had left the company, a lot of quality had been taken out of our products. Only 44% of our products were preferred to competition, despite the fact that we were typically premium priced in most of our categories. Our brands had not been supported adequately, and so a number of our franchises had really fallen down. And most importantly, the lifeblood of a consumer company is innovation, and it really had slowed dramatically. And so my first concern was whether or not the company could be fixed. And I came to the conclusion that, in fact, it could be. It needed some fairly radical change. But I did believe that we did have franchises that clearly could be revitalized with the appropriate investment, with the proper focus on product quality. And in addition, it was a pretty challenging time in the global economy. You know, we were in recession. The Eurozone was in bad shape, even worse shape than it is today. It was the worst recession, actually, in about 70 years. And so there were a lot of factors that were arguing against us. But I really believe that these were categories that could be revitalized. Our issue was not the categories in which we participated, but rather our share position within those categories. I believe we could reinvigorate the businesses. But I also was looking for some tailwinds. And part of what led to our strategy over time to shift the portfolio was my belief that if we could get a bigger footprint outside the US, that would provide a good tailwind to our growth. And fortunately, most of that has played out essentially as we had hoped it would.
So, you know, you did spend those 2 years running the Frito-Lay operation. Did that help you take a more risky stance when you came back? Was it kind of, I'm of the family, and yet I'm not quite of the family?
When you think about trying to change an organization, is it better to have someone who's totally from the outside or someone who's from the inside? And the reality is the right answer is both of those things. I think it was very helpful for me. I knew the company well. But to your point, I had been away for a while. In particular, one of the first things I did as I came back to Kraft was to blow up some of the matrices that had started creeping up within the company. We had a real concern about whether or not there was enough accountability. Everybody would ask, who's responsible for this? And they'd go like that. And so I really spent quite a bit of time blowing up some of these matrices to make sure that there was clear accountability to get the decision making closer to the marketplace. And that was a critical element, aside from making some people changes, which mm-hmm. is always, I mean, you got to start off with the right people on the bus. Yeah. There's no question about that. But without a doubt, I think having an outsider-insider perspective was extremely helpful to me.
So, you know, Irene, I'm a strategy professor here, and I also serve on some corporate boards. And one of the things I learned in corporate boards is there's an awfully long way from thinking of the strategy to actually getting anything done. And I'm sure you learned that over the years as well. So as you came back and looked around and thought, some things have to change, I want to go international, I want to do some things, I want to talk about that in a minute. Yep. How did you get all the people to stop doing this and start rowing in the same direction?
Well, there's no question it does start with the people. And so I actually replaced about half of the top two levels of management in the first year. And that was a combination. Some of them came from the outside. It was very helpful to have some new blood and some new thinking. But a lot of them were just folks that were that I promoted from within the company that bought into what we were trying to do. I talked a lot about growth. This is a company that had been very, very focused on cost cutting for many years. And in fact, that's what had led to some of the actions that I described in terms of product quality and the lack of marketing support. But it was really important to find people who were really up for the mission, that were up for the challenge of turning the place around. But I also made a number of changes in terms of the incentive system. When I came back, we had some bookshelves of manuals that were probably four or 5 inches thick, describing the objectives for the year. That's a really hard thing to govern behavior. And so we boiled it down to three very simple metrics that we are using even to this day: organic revenue growth, operating profit growth, and cash flow. And we focused everybody on that. We set up their bonus both in the short term and in the long term based on those objectives. And we made it quite clear what the targets were and who was accountable for them. And so the people played a critical role. I think people and clarity of purpose was really important. The latter point turned out to be a bigger deal than I thought. For many of our businesses, in the course of the first couple of years, I shed a couple of longtime craft businesses like Post Cereals and DiGiorno Pizza, and I bought the Lou business, the Lou biscuit business from Danone, and I bought the Cadbury chocolate business, which of course was a rather public story. And in the course of doing that, we had a lot of new people coming into the company, and they'd say, "Well, what do you stand for?" And so we spent a lot of time talking about what did we stand for, what were our values, what was our higher purpose. Nobody comes to work, as you all well know, just to come and make money and to make our shareholders happy. And so the benefits of talking to the organization about why we were in this business, what was the higher purpose of working for our company, was a really important part of the journey. And I'd say the last piece of it was, at the same time we were doing all these things, we needed the money to invest in our brands, in our people. And so we launched a very aggressive productivity program, which continues to this day to help to provide the fuel for our growth.
So I know, in part because you're a marketing person, and we know, all the students know, marketing people like to have things like four P's, that yes. You have your own four P's in running Mondelez. And I've heard a couple of those P's already in your conversation. Yeah. Can you lay out for them the Rosenfeld four P's?
The Rosenfeld P's. So, I mean, it starts with people. And I've said a few things about the people. But as I said, it was about the right people on the bus. I changed out quite a bit of the management. And we felt very comfortable that our top leadership team was very much up for the journey that we needed to be on. It was clear we had a lot of work to do in the first couple of years to get this business turned around. And so we made some significant leadership changes. We made some changes, as I said, in their incentives. And importantly, this is an organization that had been underperforming for quite some time. And yet when I came back, 40% of our folks were rated as high potential, and that sure didn't quite compute. And so we did a much better job of raising the bar on performance and being a lot more discriminating in terms of what top-tier performance looked like. And so from a people standpoint, I believe all of those actions together created a much more focused and motivated workforce. The portfolio piece was a big deal. It started, as I mentioned, with reinvestment in our core franchises, but I did have to make some portfolio moves, as I described, and I really believed that that would help to give us a lot more of a tailwind by finding ourselves more in higher growth snacking categories. I love snacking. One of the things I certainly enjoyed about my time at Frito-Lay is that too is a snack business, and there's a lot to like about snacking. Snacking is a growing consumer behavior around the world. It is highly correlated with GDP, and so as we see wealth rising, particularly in the emerging markets, we see a very straight one-to-one correlation with consumption of packaged snacks. And so the opportunity to put more of our portfolio into snacking was a big idea. And so when I came back to the company, about 29% of our business was snacking. Today, it's about 75%. Mm. And that's been a phenomenal tailwind. When I came back to the company, about 13% of our sales were in the emerging markets. Today, it's over 40%. And so again, those were just tailwinds that inherently helped us. We also focused our resources. It is very tempting when you have operations around the world. We sell products in 165 countries. Not all of them are equally important. And making the decision as to where we want to invest our resources was really important to us. And we looked at a couple of factors. We looked at margin, we looked at materiality, and we looked at momentum. And based on that, we identified those businesses that we thought were worth investing in. And those were the businesses that actually carried us forward. And so the ability to make those portfolio choices to then, within our portfolio, distort our resources toward what we call our power brands. And Ted mentioned some of them, but those are the places where we typically have margins that are 100 to 200 basis points higher than average. They have great growth trends, and by distorting our resources toward those brands, that gave us an inherent tailwind. I mentioned productivity because, as I said, that is the fuel that enables us to invest in growth. We focused on procurement, we focused on manufacturing synergy, and we focused on overheads. And all of those actions together allowed us to step up our productivity delivery and allow us to invest in our franchises as well as drop more money to the bottom line. And then last but not least, as I mentioned, this higher purpose was a really big deal. We identified seven values. We could have done it in a little conference room, just our top management team, but we actually opened it up to the entire world. We had these global chats with all of our colleagues. We asked them what they felt the company stood for, what was working, what wasn't working, and together we crafted the seven values that guide our company today. And they're fairly intuitive. They're things like tell it like it is, keep it simple, inspire trust, be open and inclusive, get going, discuss, decide, and deliver, act like an owner. They're very simple values, but they have a very profound impact on helping to guide people as well as to help to create the kind of culture that we want to operate in. So those are my four P's.
So you better remember, when you hear four P's, don't just think it's about price and place and all those things.
No.
Sudhir is telling you.
So those are important also, though, I'm sure.
So I want to think a little bit about the globalization issue. As you know, Ted, when he came in as dean, has been bringing us into the world much more rapidly than we were moving into the world before, just as you've done with your organization. And, you know, there is a tension here between whether what it is you're going to bring Oreos to the world, which I know you've done, as opposed to bring identify other products
yep.
in other countries and embrace them. How much do you try to Americanize the world, and how much do you try to go with the world and bring some of the rest of the world to us? How do you think about your product strategy in that sense?
Yeah. You have to do both. I do think one of our competitive advantages as a global player is that we have the ability to create platforms that can be expanded around the world. So Oreo, for example, is today almost a $3 billion business. It was about $1 billion 5 years ago. And so just the act of bringing Oreo elsewhere in the world has had a profound effect. It's now the number one biscuit in China, as an example. But it's not Oreo as just as you know it. We started with the Oreo as you know it, and it failed miserably. It was too sweet, it was too big, it was too expensive. And when we allowed our local team the flexibility to think about how they might reshape Oreo to better fit the needs, for example, of Chinese consumers, it led them to a very different profile. It's a much less sweet product. It's a wafer. We sell a wafer product in China. We sell green tea flavored Oreos. And that bundle, we also, you know, our marketing programs travel quite nicely. The twist, lick, and dunk idea traveled very well with Yao Ming in China. We were able to leverage a very well-known Chinese dunking icon. But we took advantage of the fact that there are thousands of bicycles in Beijing, and so we used tire inserts that were in the shape of an Oreo to allow an army of merchandisers to ride around the city and introduce our product. So it's got to be a balance, but for us, the premise of having global platforms like Oreo, like Belvita breakfast biscuits, that's a small product that started. It was a Lou product that we bought. It was a small product in France called Petit Déjeuner, which was a sort of a generic offering, which just means breakfast. We rebundled it, we repackaged it, we called it Belvita Good Life, and it's been a smashing success for us. Today it's about a $500 million business. And so the benefits of finding these platforms, what we are seeing is that we're able to cluster markets based on consumer behavior. So for example, there are certain markets in which biscuits are eaten for breakfast and others where they're not. And so understanding which those markets are helps us then to better understand which of our marketing plans will work in one market versus the other. The other thing we're learning is that the state of maturity of a market has a very profound impact. Very often, you know, if we took the Oreo marketing program from the United States and tried to bring it to Brazil, we just launched Oreo in Brazil about 6 months ago. If we just took that program directly, it wouldn't be very helpful because the consumer here knows Oreos backwards and forwards, and it was a new entity to consumers in Brazil. And so we also have identified a life cycle profile for each of our key brands so that we understand what you do first, second, and third in the course of the life cycle. So for example, you don't want to introduce vanilla Oreo in year one. If you're trying to establish what is an Oreo is a chocolate-filled sandwich for the most part, and you want to stay there for a while before you start to move into line extensions. So it is a balance of global, we call it global. It's the global together with the local that really is the winning hand. But it is tempting. Every local manager wants to tell you why their market is different. And to the ability to have the data and the information that you need to overcome that is a key piece of what we have to do.
So it's interesting. One of the questions that we got from our global network student was exactly on Oreos and Oreo cookies entry into China. And I'm just going to give him credit, Nelson Liu from Renmin in China. So obviously your story about succeeding with Oreos in China has permeated through to the Chinese students out there who, hearing the name of the company, have noted the success of the Oreos and wondered, how did you do it? So Nelson, you got your answer in the middle of the speech. So these are successes, but I know one of the things you're also known for as a leader is taking risks.
Yep.
And one of the issues with taking risks is it doesn't always work out so well. So tell me a little bit about some things that haven't worked out so well, yep, and how you empower the people around you to take risks, and what enables you to take the risks.
You know, if you keep your foot firmly planted on first base, you cannot steal second base. I mean, it's really important that you be willing to venture out and try some new things if you're ever going to make progress or make some significant progress. And so for our team, it's about making sure you've done your homework and you have a plan B and that you learn from what just happened. So I'll give you an example that you might be reading about as we speak. It's very much current on the internet. We just launched a campaign for our Honey Made Graham products called Family. In it, we featured a variety of contemporary families. Some of them were not as well received by certain audiences out in the U.S. As we would have liked. We understood full well, as we were showing two fathers together, as we were showing some interracial couples, as we were showing a variety of glimpses of modern families, that they might not, that the audience might not respond so well. But we had done our homework. We felt our message is about the wholesomeness and the goodness of Honey Made Grahams. And we thought the ability to tie that message into family was a really important one. We understood full well that we'd hear we'd get some feedback, and we have. And what I'm proud to tell you is if you go on the internet and you look up this ad, what you will then see is our response to the ad. And what the team did that was so brilliant is they actually got a lot of negative responses. They typed them up, and they hired some artists who put together essentially a graphic that spells the word love with all these tubes of negative reactions. And it's a profound video. It's gone viral, and I can't tell you how proud I am of what the team has done. And it comes from the fact that they understood full well that they were doing something that was going to have some risk. They were prepared for the risk, and they knew what they were going to do in response to that. And I think setting that kind of a tone is critical to be able to be successful. Obviously, the Cadbury acquisition was probably the biggest risk that I took before I split the company, which then turned out to be a bigger risk. But Cadbury was an interesting challenge. It was a transatlantic deal. We were dealing with it was a cash and stock deal. So every day, the value of our offer changed as the relationship between the dollar and the pound sterling changed, as our stock price went up or down. There was a point in time about 3 months into our offer where actually our offer was lower than the initial offer we had made. And so it was incredibly a very volatile issue. We had four regulatory agencies involved. There were two in the UK and two in the US. None of them had the same filing requirements, and so we were constantly having to see what we needed to do. We were actually, as a result of the fact that we had a six-hour difference, I'd go to bed at night, and everything was fine. I'd wake up in the morning, and all hell had broken loose over in the UK. And last but not least, it was an election year. And there was enormous animosity toward this American company. It was trying to steal their curly whirlies. And so it was a very challenging time. I personally was under quite a bit of scrutiny. But we had done our homework. We knew that this was the right thing to do. We knew it would be transformational. As I mentioned before, we went from 13% of our business in emerging markets to today 40%. That was a combination of Lou, but primarily Cadbury. And it was just a transformational acquisition, which not only solidified our position in chocolate, we are the largest chocolate manufacturer in the world today, but it also solidified our position in these emerging markets. So I think the moral of the story is you got to take risks, but I also think the key is to have a plan B for what you're going to do. And we were never in a position where if the Cadbury transaction had not worked out, we didn't have another alternative. And I think that's really key to your ability to comfortably take risk.
So another risk you might think was the 2012 split off.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about what motivated that. Why did you think it was necessary to split the two pieces of the business off, which in some ways feel like they're kind of complementary one to another? So how did you think about, and how is it working out?
Well, you know, I'm quite pleased with how it's worked out so far. We've created on any given day somewhere between upwards of $30 billion of market cap. So I feel pretty good about how it has played out. You know, bankers are often often pushing splits, and it actually has become very much au courant, I would say. But the
my impression is bankers are pushing anything that earns a fee.
Well, that's partly why we're pushing the splits. In our case, the possibility that we might get a higher multiple was the least of our concerns. The real reason we chose to split the company is because I really believe we could operate it better. We could operate the two parts better separate than we could together. And the reason I said that is increasingly, as we started to broaden our snacking footprint, we had a snacking portfolio and a non-snacking portfolio. And particularly in North America, so much of our business was non-snacking. In fact, only about a third of our North American business was in snacking. We had Oscar Mayer, we had Jell-O, we had a number of other products in the portfolio, Kraft cheese. And so it was increasingly clear that there was a warehouse grocery business, and then there was a biscuit business that primarily in the U.S. was a direct store delivery business. And the opportunity to focus our resources on those two businesses independently was quite appealing to us. And we did a lot of work to think about, to analyze what we could do better if we were running these two businesses separately. And it's played out essentially the way we thought. We had a sales force that was selling over 60 different product categories. We were able to now focus those resources either on selling biscuits or on selling center of the store grocery items. And as a result of that, I think both groups are performing better than we would have seen otherwise. So I feel quite good about the results of the split. The focus today of having a business that's 75% in snacking allows us to share these global platforms that I talked about to more rapidly disseminate best practices from one part of the world to the other. And I think that focus has been quite helpful to us.
So you probably don't want to comment on this, but please do if you do. It's quite different from the PepsiCo strategy that Indra has pursued and that you lived under for a few years as as the runner of Frito-Lay in terms of the kind of broad spread rather than the focus. So maybe we'll talk about that over lunch too. I want to think a little bit. It's called the Leaders Forum, and I'm going to give you all a chance to ask questions in a few minutes, but a little bit about your leadership style. I think we're already seeing something of your leadership style. Many of our students, they want to be leaders. They want to run something. Advice to them of the things I've learned running organizations that they should keep close to their heart as they go on in their lives. That's going to help them be better leaders, and some things that they better not do.
You know, I think the thing I put at the top of the list is to make a difference, whatever you choose to do. It is so easy to take on a job and just kind of fly under the radar screen and just bide your time until your next promotion comes along. And you know, my best advice to you is whatever you choose to do, make sure that position is better for your having been there than somebody else. And I think it's a, it does pay enormous dividends. And I would say my own personal experience was that the ability to be noticed and to have been able to have an impact was greatly helped by my desire to make sure that whatever I was doing, I was adding some value. I would say the second is to take risks. As I said before, it's a critical piece. You really just can't have a big outcome if you continue. If you do what you always did, you get what you always got. And I think the benefits of, I talk to my guys about taking risks, and I talk to them about the difference between prudent risks and stupid risks. There is a difference. And prudent risks are ones where you understand the what could go wrong, you understand what the benefits are, and you think about how to help realize those opportunities, and you help to mitigate the risks. But taking risks, I think, is an important part. The don't that I'd offer to you is I'm a big proponent of the golden rule. I talk about that a lot. And you know, you're all going to get this very fancy degree from a very wonderful school, and you're going to walk into wherever you walk into, and you're going to feel like you ought to be in charge. And the facts are there'll be some folks there that have been there for a while, and there's a lot you can learn from cultivating those people and learning from them. And so I think treating others the way you would want to be treated, whoever they are, at whatever level in the organization they are, was a really important lesson for me, and I think it would be an important one that I'd share with you. And the last one I'd tell you is to ask for what you want. There's always a sense as you move along in your career that everyone understands what you're looking for, and then eventually opportunities come up and they may not come to you, and you say, boy, how did that happen? And the answer is that there's a lot going on in a company, particularly in a big company, and the ability to be clear about what you're looking for, what you're willing to do, what your aspirations are, to the right people. I mean, I think you don't need to wear it on your sleeve, but the opportunity to share that information with your manager or your HR leader is really helpful. I personally benefited greatly. One of my roles along the way was to run Kraft Canada, and it happened. I was having a routine dinner with my boss, and he asked me what I wanted to do next. And first of all, you always ought to be ready with an answer to that question, even if you're at the gym. Just what am I going to do next? But he asked me what I wanted to do next, and I said, I have not run a full-fledged P&L. And at that time, there were two operations in our company that had a full-fledged P&L. One was Oscar Mayer in Madison, Wisconsin, and the other was Kraft Canada up in Toronto. And I said, that's what I'd really like to do. Now, at that time, both of those jobs had very well-respected leaders in place, and so I didn't really think much about it. But about 3 weeks later, I got a call. It turned out, unbeknownst to me, the president of Kraft Canada had quit. And so this was a very timely piece of information, a very timely conversation. And I would tell you that I was not necessarily on their radar screen as someone they would have asked. I had a family, I wasn't clear if my husband would move, and so it was so helpful that I had shared that information, and so I do think the other tip I'd suggest to you is to ask for what you want, know what you want, and make sure that somebody else in the organization knows about it.
You know, it's interesting you say that, because the social science literature, you may well know, suggests that women in particular in the corporate setting do not always ask for what they want. There's a little bit more reluctance to do that, and I think for all kinds of reasons, it's at least as important for women to ask it.
I would agree. And one of my favorite quotes is Golda Meir apparently reportedly once said to Moshe Dayan, "Don't be so humble, you're not so great." But I do think women do have a particularly challenging time tooting their own horns and raising their hands, and you just might, my advice to those of you in the room here is just overcome your natural tendency, because again, it is a reality that those that are the most vocal and the most out there typically get more attention. It's just the way of the world. It's particularly relevant in a large organization.
So I notice as you're doing that, you, like all of us these days, are leaning in.
Yes,
you're conversing it. And we had this conversation earlier, PhD and CEO. Now that must be, I am wondering whether there are any other CEOs who are also PhDs. And I'm hoping it's going to turn out that it's a tremendous advantage to you, to have all of that academic research under your belt and all of those analytical skills. Because now and again, we teach these classes and we're sort of thinking to ourselves, do they really think anything we teach them, is it all useful? So how do you think it's affected you that you were quite a different background, not a standard MBA, not that our MBAs are standard, but
You know, one of the greatest correlates with success in business and many other careers is learning agility. And so for me, the PhD was as much about the opportunity to stretch myself and to learn how to learn, which I think is as important as anything. And that's the real value that it has brought to me. I've learned a couple of tricks along the way. In fact, Casey Deere and I had a chance to celebrate our mutual, my dissertation advisor celebrated his 80th birthday, and we were in Chicago to celebrate his many, many accomplishments. And he taught me conjoint analysis. And now what the hell do you do with conjoint analysis? In fact, the person who wrote my speech was trying to write my speech for the night. She wrote about conjoint analysis. And I said, no, it's not about twins. It's about, it's a mathematical thing. But I do think the ability to not be afraid to ask questions is what that experience most brought to me, and I do think it's been invaluable from that perspective. So I'm not necessarily on any regular basis making use of a lot of my background. I certainly, I started off in consumer research, and that was a lot more of what I had studied. But the truth of the matter is, it's much more about willingness to be comfortable asking questions and to continue to learn and to not be afraid to venture into some areas that you don't know what you're doing. And I think that was the greatest lesson I got.
So that's interesting, because I would say when I talk to professors, myself and others who are on boards, we also will say the biggest advantage is you think you're smart enough, you should understand, and if you don't, you're going to ask why not.
Yes, yes.
And so I think that's
it. Yeah, a lot of people just nod knowingly, and they have no idea what you just said.
But they don't ever expect to know. So all of you are supposed to expect to understand what goes on. So I'm going to turn up to the questions. As I said, you already answered a question from Mr. Liu from Renmin, but I have a question on the global strategy, not surprisingly, from the Global Network, from Marcelo Nietzsche from FGV in Sao Paulo, Brazil. And it speaks to something you began to speak about, but I'd love to hear more about it. Do you believe that developing local customized products or investing in the global leading brands is a better strategy? So talk a little bit about, you think you called it glocal.
Yes. I feel pretty strongly that investing in global brands that are locally relevant is the winning ticket. And I say that for a couple of reasons. First of all, as we think about making investment in our assets, it makes a lot more sense. We get so much more scale when we're ordering a line that we've used elsewhere in the world that has produced many such products. The opportunities to bring marketing scale to benefit from some of the learning that we've had from one market to the next is invaluable, as opposed to each market making it up themselves. But I would tell you, for example, in Sao Paulo, we have a product called Lacta, a chocolate product. It is the leading chocolate brand called Lacta. We've just taken a lot of we take a lot of the marketing behind Milka and Cadbury Dairy Milk and just bring it to Lacta. So for example, we have a proprietary resealable package that allows you to seal the product up so you don't eat the whole thing in one sitting. We have a number of bite-size offerings that we've been able to bring to Lacta. We introduced an aerated version of our products last year called Bubbly that we brought to Lacta. So even in cases where you have a very strong local brand, you can still benefit from the R&D investment and some of the manufacturing know-how that you would have from elsewhere in the world. So I do think it is that balance, but there's no question the companies that are able to leverage their scale on a broader basis have a competitive advantage, because otherwise you're competing one-on-one. You're no better than any of the local producers, and you've got to bring something more to the party.
Do you see more homogenization of consumer tastes than you saw when you first started in this business?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, food still is very much a local phenomenon, much more so than personal care products, for example. But without a doubt, we are seeing that there's just a lot more commonality in terms of taste profiles. There's an emerging trend these days towards stronger flavorings, for example, and that just reflects the demographics of the world population is getting older. Their taste buds are getting a little more dull. And as a result, everybody wants a little more flavoring.
I hope there's a spicy sandwich for later for me.
Well, if you try our Triscuits and our Wheat Thins, the heat rating has gone up geometrically. But without a doubt, there are more and more commonalities. I think, as I mentioned earlier, because snacking is such a pervasive behavior around the world, it comes from the fact that so many women are working outside the home. Mm-hmm. Traditional meals are less a part of most consumers' lives. That then leads to willingness to then try products. The kinds of products that we're offering. So Belvita is a breakfast biscuit. It's as relevant in Brazil as it is in France, as it is in Malaysia. And so we're finding, now the seasoning is a little bit different. We do find the products have different moisture contents. Even our Cadbury Dairy Milk, for example, is a slightly different formula from one market to the next. But the fundamental product offerings, there's a lot of commonality.
So I want you to think about your question, which I'm going to ask one more, and then it's your turn. So we, of course, celebrate your daughter as well, who's an excellent student and a testament to your ability to combine a very demanding career with an ability to raise a wonderful child. Maybe you have more as well. I don't know.
She has a sister.
Okay, good. Hopefully equally wonderful. So the question is, in your own role now as CEO, which you've done for a while, are there things you're doing that are family-friendly at your organization that reflect your own experience in trying to do this balancing?
Very much so. One of the things I'm so proud of for Mondelez and then Kraft as the predecessor company is that we've had a fabulous track record with respect to diversity and inclusion. And that speaks to the composition of our management teams, it speaks to the nature of our advancement policies, but it also speaks to the nature of our programming. And we've tried very hard to introduce more flexibility into our programs. I tell our guys all the time that the best thing we can do is to create an environment where people are comfortable telling it like it is and being straight with us. So as an example, we're just closing our books as we speak for the first quarter. In fact, when I leave here today, I'm going to get our final numbers. And I was talking to our head of forecasting and planning over the weekend, and I needed to ask him something. We were emailing back and forth. And at one point, he said to me, hey, I'm in Chinatown. can I get back to you? And I said, absolutely. And I think the willingness to the ability to create an environment where it's okay to say, do you need it right now? Mm-hmm. Where people are comfortable asking that. And importantly, back to the notion of you as an employee being comfortable asking for what you want. So we continue to work hard to create an environment where everybody feels they can bring their whole selves to work, because I think that's the only way to do it. The guy I was describing who was down in Chinatown is a single dad with four kids. He's got quite a hefty workload, and he's our head of forecasting and planning. So he's got a pretty big set of tasks to accomplish. And I think it's really important that if we really want to attract the best talent, it's critically important to us that we figure out how to accommodate people's lives within the context of our business needs.
Okay, so I think we have 10 minutes or so to hear from all of you. So who would like to ask the first question? And I am told.
Mike's.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for coming. We kind of related to the.
Why don't you introduce yourself? Sorry.
Michael Malmberg, second year, class 2014. I'm curious, kind of related to the HoneyMaid marketing program. What do you think the role of a CEO's personal values are in making decisions for a major global company?
Yeah.
Think Mozilla.
Yes. Yes. There's no question that the head of the organization sets a tone, and from there flows a lot of the corporate culture. I do think that the ability to once again to create an open environment where there's not just one model. I mean, I think if you were to look at my management team, for example, there's very, very different behavioral, educational profiles, as well as leadership styles. And I think that's just a critical part of your ability to create an environment where people are able to do their best work.
Yes.
Hi, thanks for coming this morning. I'm Andrew Warner, a first-year student. And I noticed that you are really careful when you brand your products as far as biscuits and snack food. And I can't help but thinking that some people would think of a lot of your products as junk food. And in the society sort of mission of our school, a lot of people are worried about childhood obesity. So what are sort of your thoughts on that epidemic in America, and how do you position your brand to sort of lead the edge in, you know, attacking that and trying to dispel that?
Well, we are the largest snacking company in the world, and we take our obligation to address obesity, which is one of the most profound epidemics in the world, quite seriously. We do think biscuits is a vehicle to help to do that, and we do it in a couple of ways. First is to make sure that we're taking as much of the negatives out of our products as we can. We've made a number of commitments over the last couple of years about saturated fat, as well as salt and sodium and sugar, and we continue to do what we can to bring those levels down without compromising taste. We have a lot of work going on in technology to help us to increase the whole grain content. So, for example, if you look at products like Triscuits and Wheat Thins, we've significantly expanded their nutritional profile, the Honeymade products as well. And so we're looking for the opportunity to reduce the negatives, add the positives. A lot of our development work, though, is in what we call better choice products. And those are just designed to meet certain regulatory hurdles. So, for example, we're looking typically for snacks that would be under 200 calories because we believe, and if you look at the calories consumed in an average diet, that we believe that that represents the proper portion size. And so we do it both in terms of the development of the product as well as in terms of the packaging. Increasingly, particularly in a lot of the emerging markets, we're selling our products in smaller pack sizes. A lot of the stuff you'd be familiar with here comes in these large family sizes, but as I mentioned, chocolate, but biscuit as well, we increasingly offer resealable packages, single-serve packages. We've been pioneers in front-of-pack labeling to help make it easier for consumers to know what the calorie content is. But the reality is, it is about calories in and calories out. And so we've also been very active sponsors of nutritional training as well as physical fitness programs in a number of markets around the world, because the reality is it's not just an issue of what people are consuming, but it's also the fact that they're leading rather sedentary lifestyles. So we take it quite seriously, and as I said, we've made a number of public commitments to the profile of our products. We said that by 2015, about 30% of our products will be in this better choice arena. The good news is, not surprisingly, that's the stuff that's growing the fastest. So it actually is, it's good for the world and it's good business for us as well.
Thank you.
Yes, Anita.
So one of the things that we're seeing in food and beverage more generally are companies like Coke and Nestle going into the bottom of the pyramid. And the two conflicts that I see in this is, you know, is this CSR or is this a new market? And the second question is, are we going to see the long-term kind of results now, and if we don't, are we willing to let the business go through a little bit of red to kind of see the potential benefit and excitement that lies in that market?
I do believe very strongly that you have to think about the triple bottom line and each piece of it. There's no question it is a challenge to sustain a program that doesn't have an economic return. And I would tell you, my experience at Kraft and now at Mondelez, we've set some very aggressive sustainability targets for the company. And we weren't getting too far when they were just a bunch of targets because it was the right thing to do. And when all of a sudden we were able to tie some of those targets to our ability to save money and to increase our supply of a number of our raw materials, that's when the thing took up. And so I do think it's got to be a combination of protecting the products, the people, and the planet, but they have to go together. I think it is very difficult to sustain interest and enthusiasm and, in fact, economic support if you don't have all of those things going for it. That said, we are finding that, for example, we introduced Oreos in India about 3 years ago. We actually introduced a product similar to the Western product, and it's actually been quite successful. But economically, it's not so successful yet because the margin structure isn't really where it needs to be. And we've done a lot of good work as to what we need to do to redesign the product. And together, that's actually going to make a big difference. And I'll give you an example. It turns out that the Indian consumer is not as excited about that dark chocolate appearance that American consumers are. They actually prefer a lighter color. Well, the lighter color happens to have less cocoa powder, which is therefore a cost savings at the same time. And so there are opportunities when you understand the local business and you set that as your objective, you can manage to meet all of those criteria. But I do think they have to go together. In the short term, we committed to using sustainable palm oil, for example, in our products. We actually met our objective last year. We were supposed to have hit the objective by the end of this year. In the early days, it was a 35-cent upcharge per pound, but we knew it was the right thing to do. We understood that over time, demand would be supply would catch up with demand, but eventually they do have to catch up, or else it's very difficult to sustain.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. Yes.
Brock McCarollo, class of 2015. You touched upon the Cadbury deal a little bit. I remember, at the time, it was the lead business story for 4 months. And I remember an inflection point for me when I was following that deal was when Warren Buffett came out against the deal, but in support of your leadership.
Yes.
When you learned that he was the largest shareholder of Kraft at the time, what was your instinct and, how did you handle that very large, vocal, and it was a very rare event for him. He doesn't do that very often. How did you handle that relationship?
If you've read anything about Mr. Buffett, what he tells you is that when you make an acquisition, he buys two cards, a congratulatory card and a sympathy card. And then he waits 5 years to decide which to send to you. He hasn't sent me my card, but he's told me he feels good about the money he made on our stock. But the facts are, it was a difficult time, and I give my board a lot of credit. Back to Sharon's question about how do you take risk? Well, a lot of it is you got to make sure you do your homework, and then you got to stay the course. And so when I understood that he was not in support of the deal, we talked with the board about it, and they said, look, this is clearly the right thing for our shareholders. We've done an enormous amount of due diligence on this, and we're going to stay the course. He's just one shareholder, and we did stay the course, and it's proven to be every bit the success we had hoped it was going to be. But a couple of sleepless nights during that period, I must admit.
So I have one last question. Yes.
Yeah. All of a sudden moving to another region, and it's almost like it's very stuck contrast.
There's two, it's a very important question for a couple of reasons. There's both the consumer aspect of it, but there's also an important cost aspect to it. We have 151 different strawberry flavors in Latin America. And I don't know what the right number is, but I know 151 is too many. And so, each of those flavors has a consumer franchise, and consumers have gotten used to that taste. And so in many cases, we have to do our homework. We do what we call alienation testing. We look to see who does not, which product is not preferred, and then how badly do they hate the one that they didn't like. We also typically, when we make a change, unlike a new Coke type situation, we typically try to do it a little more gradually so that you can kind of wean consumers a little bit off the taste. But interestingly, Cadbury Dairy Milk in the UK is a different formula than in Ireland, not only a different formula, but a radically different cost profile. And so we spend a lot of time thinking about where are the places that we can harmonize, and where are the places that those differences are important to protect? And it's a little bit of an art and a science, but it's a very important issue, And we take it very seriously, and we don't make those changes before we're quite confident that the product that we want to introduce will be successful.
So I think our time is up. Students have to go to another class. This has been wonderful. I enjoyed getting to know you a little bit, and I think the students have really had a treat here today. So thank you, Irene, for coming.
Thank you.